Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 25th January 2019. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims are these 8. First article is about solid waste management. Second article is about the PSLV rocket launch of ISRO. Third article is about the e-courts of India and the common service centers in our country. Fourth article is about the nitrogen pollution, and the fifth one is about the global multidimensional poverty index. Sixth article talks about the Bandipur wildlife sanctuary. The seventh article talks about strategic partnership between India and South Africa, and the final one is about the warm hits in Sri Lanka among the maize farmers. The first article for the day is National Green Tribunal seeks report on solid waste management. This article was taken from the paper Hindu. So in the year 2016, the Government of India released the solid waste management rules. However, these rules have not been implemented properly in almost all the states in our country. So in order to correct that, National Green Tribunal has summoned the chief secretaries of all the states of India as well as union territories to support a detailed report on solid waste management by March 1st. So parallelly, along with economic development in our country, the solid waste generated and collected is also exponentially increasing. The solid waste, according to Environment Ministry, is broadly classified into 4 types. First one is municipal solid waste, second one is e-waste, third type is plastic waste, and the final one is bio-waste or the medical waste. So approximately almost 4 lakh tons of electronic waste is generated every year, follow 1.7 tons of medical waste as well as 48 million tons of municipal waste every year. If this trend of waste generation goes on, according to World Bank estimates, by the year 2025, the daily waste generation in India will almost touch 377,000 tons. So without any proper management facilities for management of the generated waste, it will have implicit impact on human health, which will also affect quality of living of Indian citizens, which will have devastating effect also on the environment. So now let's see about solid waste management rules of 2016. So the first important point of solid waste management rules is source segregation. The waste must be segregated by the waste generator into wet, dry, or hazardous waste. The wet waste are either organic waste or kitchen waste. These can be used for generation of biogas. The dry waste, which can be recycled, such as plastics, disposable cups, goes to recycling facility. The hazardous waste, such as batteries, medical waste, can be incinerated. The rules also mandate setting up of waste processing facilities in every single town of population 1 million or more. The rules also talks about integration of rag pickers into sources of formal sector by the state government. In the places where special economic zones or big industrial units are built up, they must allocate 5% of the total area for setting up of an individual recovery and recycling facility. The second article for the day is PSLV carries reusable final stage rocket, first in India and for the world. This article was taken from Mint. Yesterday, ISRO launched 2 satellites by using its PSLV launch vehicle. So the first satellite is MicroSat, which was placed in low Earth orbit of about 277 km from the surface of Earth. So this sat is specially designed for the satellite imaging and surveillance operations of defense. That is, this satellite is specially designed for performing satellite operations and surveillance operations for DRDO. On the other hand, there was also a nanosat called as KalamSat, which was also sent to space via this PSLV. So what is special about this KalamSat? So PSLV ideally has 4 stages, 2 solid stages and 2 liquid stages. The final stage is a liquid stage, usually becomes debris after the launch. However, in this launch, ISRO made this final stage as an experimental platform. This fourth and final stage of the rocket, which normally turns into debris after ejecting the satellite, will continue to stay in space at about 450 km from the surface of the Earth, and it will perform various basic experiments in the space. The next article we'll be seeing is E-Code Service 2 Common Service Centers. This article was taken from PIB. There are about 2.5 crores of cases pending in Indian judicial system. However, on the other hand, there is also increasing digital penetration in many parts of our country. The rate of digital penetration is low in rural areas, and in order to address this digital divide in rural places which doesn't have access to internet, the Department of Justice has created a new initiative wherein it uses the already existing common service centers under Digital India platform to provide efficient and time-bound access in the form of e-codes to citizens of our country. These e-codes, which are developed by India as a part of India National E-Governance Project, will provide case code information such as judicial proceedings, case registration, case status, daily orders and even final judgments via computerized district and subordinate courts in all the common service centers in our country. By providing these information via digital platform, it has huge potential to reduce the time taken to offer justice to Indian citizens. The next article we'll be seeing is 18 Indian institutions to study nitrogen pollution. This article was taken from Hindu. We all know about the increasing global warming. As well as climate change going all over the world. However, we need data to study the process in order to take mitigating effect. So for that, a group of 50 institutions called the South Asian Nitrogen Hub have been conducting nitrogen pollution impact studies in South Asia. This is parallel to similar studies which was conducted last year by a group of Indian scientists in our country. So now for prelims, we have to know about the impact of nitrogen and nitrous oxide pollution in our country. So if you take nitrogen as an individual component, it's an inert gas and it doesn't really react with any other components. However, when nitrogen is present along with other pollutants such as agricultural waste or industrial effluents, it becomes highly reactive and poses key threats to our environment. This nitrogen is mainly present in the form of chemical fertilizers, that is the urea, which is most predominantly used in Indian agriculture. Second is burning fossil fuels, which releases N2O, which is a toxic greenhouse gas. And this nitrogen is also released in the form of livestock manure in dairy industries. Apart from this, the nitrogen is also present as a component in sewage and biological waste, which is increasing in India. Once this nitrogen combines with oxygen and becomes N2O, that is nitrous oxide, it has various degrees of threat to our environment. First is the biodiversity loss. Because of the nitrogen effluents into the water bodies, it causes a phenomenon called as ocean acidification. This ocean acidification increases the biological oxygen demand, which in turn leads to a process called as eutrophication, which results in the death of lives in the aquatic ecosystem. Apart from this, nitrogen is also a key component in causing ozone depletion. Thus, it has various dysfunctional effects on health, economy, as well as livelihood of individuals. The next article we'll be seeing is Poverty Alleviation Rising in India, a Global Report. This article was taken from Indian Express. The Global Multidimensional Poverty Index 2018, which is released every year by United Nations Development Programme, it gives serious insights about the rate of poverty alleviation in our country. So according to the index, the rate of poverty alleviation in our country has picked up, and it gives credit especially to Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana National Rural Livelihood Mission. So we have to know about National Rural Livelihood Mission here. This mission, which is conducted under Ministry of Rural Development, provides capacity building to individuals in rural areas. Various sub-schemes which strives for rural livelihood development include Ajivika Skill Development Program, Entrepreneurship Development Program such as Self-Employment Training Institutes, Mahila Kishan Sashaktikaran Pariyojana for Empowerment of Women. These livelihood missions have contributed to increase in household mission of about 22% according to UNDP. We also have to know about the Multidimensional Poverty Index for prelims. So this Multidimensional Poverty Index is released by a specialized organization under United Nations called as United Nations Development Program. And it measures multidimensional poverty based on three main parameters, namely health, education and living standards. So under health, two main sub-parameters are included, namely nutrition and child mortality. Under education, years of schooling and school attendance are considered for the index. Living standard is calculated based on six parameters, namely cooking fuel, sanitation, drinking water, electricity, housing, as well as assets, as well as individual assets. According to 2018 report, it states that almost 1 in 5 Indians are poor, and it also gives a demographic profile based on states. And Uttar Pradesh is the most poor state, followed by Bihar and Madhya Pradesh. The next article we'll be seeing is Glimmer of Hope for State in Bandipur. So this article was taken from Hindu. In order to protect the natural habitat of animals in Bandipur Tiger Reserve, the night traffic has been banned in the Bandipur and Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary in the states of Kerala and Karnataka. However, on one hand, this protects the ecological natural habitat of the animals. This ban of traffic in National Highway 766 also caused serious traffic disruptions, which thus have economic impacts on the transportation facilities. So in order to provide solution to this, Ministry of Road Transport and Highways has a proposal to construct elevated roads through 5 sessions of Bandipur Wildlife Sanctuary stretching 35 kilometers. However, due to lack of consensus between Ministry of Environment and Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, this project has been stalled for past 6 weeks. So now Supreme Court has directed the Ministry of Environment to sort out this issue with Ministry of Road Transport and Highways so that there's efficient movement of traffic in this stretch as well as protection of natural habitat. So for the prelims, we also have to know about the Bandipur National Park. So this Bandipur National Park is a significant reserve located in the Western Ghats in our country. So it is located between Mysore and Chamarajanagar district of Karnataka. So it is a tiger reserve under Project Tiger in India, and it is a national park as well. And this also forms a part of Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve, which is a part of UNESCO Man and Biosphere Program. There are a variety of ecologically diverse species present in the Western Ghats. Some of them include tiger, sambar, mouse deer, four-horned antelope, wild dogs, panther, squirrels, etc. The next article we'll be seeing is India-South Africa to revise 22-year-old strategic partnership. So the South African president will be the Republic Day chief guest for this year. And in this visit, India and South Africa will update their strategic partnership by coming up with comprehensive roadmap as well as coming up with relaxing visa restrictions between the two countries. So the strategic partnership already existing between India and South Africa has been signed in the year 1997, and the declaration was called as Red Fourth Declaration. So South Africa and India will sign a partnership yielding to a 3-year action plan. This action plan will concentrate on areas such as security and cooperation, trade and investment between both the countries, promoting tourism areas, also harnessing the potential of blue economy, maritime cooperation, and agriculture and science and development projects as well. The final article for the day is Guam hits Sri Lanka's maize farmers. This article was taken from the paper Hindu. So this article talks about the pest attack by a species called as fall armyworm in Sri Lankan maize crops. So this fall armyworm is a moth species which feeds on the stems of the maize crops. This is a social species which comes in big groups and attacks crops, threatening tens and thousands of farmers' livelihood in Sri Lanka. The state of Kerala and Andhra Pradesh also recently experienced an outburst of fall armyworm attack on the maize crops. So this species is said to have travelled to Sri Lanka from India, carried by strong winds. So according to Food and Agricultural Organization, this pest is native to tropical and subtropical regions in Americas. However, now it has moved to Asia as well. And last year, it severe loss in different parts of our country, including states of Telangana, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, West Bengal and Gujarat, posing serious threats to livelihood of Indian farmers.